Welcome. So today we're going to be looking at 100% map completion of Malkor's Leap. Nice, efficient route to run through it. We'll be talking about memories of the game. Footage courtesy of TechZoon. Now, in terms of Guild Wars 1 comparisons, there are none here at all because this place was not available in the first game. Absolutely zero overlap. In theory, during the time of pre-searing, this place would have been explorable and would have even been visible on the world map. But when you're in pre-searing, you only get a very limited world map that just shows the region of Ascalon. You don't get to see beyond the Shiver Peaks or any of that stuff. So we never really get to see, and it's kind of funny to realize actually, or on a map or anything before it was destroyed. And we only really get it now after it has been raised again by the power of an undead dragon. So there's lots to do on this map, but I always find it a bit weird because while it does have two metas that kind of push all the way from the eastern side to the western side as we progress into ore, while it does have that, those metas feel a lot less important than the Straits of Devastation one or the ones in the coming up map in the Cursed Shore, which of course leads you to the final dungeon. The ones here are like super skippable, and I would hazard a guess that most people who are playing the game nowadays don't really have any experience of them, which is a real shame. You've also got the side that if you're just coming in for map completion like we are, with no renown hearts, you tend to beat them a bit quicker. You might have noticed the last part in this playlist if you've been following along. Straits of Devastation we did in about 25 minutes. This one we're going to be doing in about 26 minutes as well. It's not that the maps are smaller, and it's not that they have less content. It's just that for map completion, they kind of do. So some incredible lore to talk about right here. We are unfogging a place called the Pyrite Peninsula, and we're going to run over, get this hero challenge in this very bizarre looking area of ore, which is plastered with this like gold. So pyrite is like fool's gold. It's like not real gold. But this is called like the Auric Forest, and this orb is a big mystery in this area. There's actually some events to do with the inquest that are trying to study and tap into the magic here. So we know that before ore fell, it kind of had this very elaborate, magically infused, like almost like Arabic, Persian, like architectural sense. And the word gold is used to describe a lot with ore as well. But now that it's destroyed and come back, there's really no gold anywhere except for that one orb, which is a real mystery. But I think we got a big hint about recently that maybe suggests that that is actually what remains of an ancient, long forgotten, destroyed elder dragon. Yeah, seriously. It's very unlikely that this was an elder dragon active in recent cycles, but maybe far enough back, yes, it was a dragon that was destroyed somehow. And that might even explain why Zaitan is here. Perhaps Zaitan is the thing that destroyed that. If you buy this theory that it's what remains of an elder dragon. And maybe that was like a gold inclined elder dragon or something. Then also maybe when the Aurians came here, they were like tapping into its essence somehow and using that to build their grand, amazing architecture and stuff. In fact, if you look in the footage in these maps, if you look very carefully, you can find these truly enormous, like gargantuan, massive archways that extend what feels like miles into the sky. It's one of the most impressive, cool things about all. When you look up and you see all the airships fighting the dragons and stuff, but you also see these big archways, and they kind of like spiral out all the way into the heart of the city of the gods, Arrah. It's really amazing. You can see a couple on this map. And it's like, well, how did the Aurians really do this? Was it just because of the gods and the magic that the gods gave the humans? Did the gods themselves build this stuff? Or was there something else going on? Did they have other power? Was it because there was a leaking elder dragon asleep under this realm? Was it maybe because of that orb there? And they're interesting ideas. The orb also had a weird update during Living World Season 2, where the devs added a bunch of weird items to the game, and you can kind of take them and interact with that orb there, but nothing happened. It just like leads to nothing. So it's really strange. I still kind of wonder if there's like hidden content that no one's seen. That might sound crazy, but Guild Wars 2 has had several examples over the years of big things in the game just no one had seen or understood. And sometimes the devs come out and say, yeah, by the way, there's some stuff that you don't know about. But it can take a long time for the community to latch onto stuff, especially if most of the population is shunted into the newer expansions and aren't spending their time en masse in these maps anymore. But yeah, that happens a lot, particularly with the Mystic Forge recipes and stuff like that. So you never know. Anyway, it's one of the real highlights of this map, probably one of the reasons I talked about it so much. There's some other nice Easter eggs. This area always makes me think of the jumping puzzle down in the water. In fact, we'll be jumping down to get the POI there, but we won't actually be going any further. I always get this jumping puzzle confused with one in a later map, where you have to collect loads of orbs, kind of, ostensibly, the final jumping puzzle of Guild Wars 2 in the next map. I always get the two confused, and whenever I try to go do the orb one, I end up here. Up on that bridge up there as well is a really nice little Easter egg with a tomb that if you kneel at it, you can actually summon a lich that will fight you. The liches, the undead risen liches that you find in more abundance in these later maps, I'm not sure are fully associated with the kind of lich that Kil'Bron was. Maybe they are the same. I mean, graphically they look very different, but I tend to not put much stock into the way things look because, you know, the visuals can be transcribed in quite profound ways between the two games. Like, Oak Hearts in Guild Wars 1 are the same in lore as Oak Hearts in Guild Wars 2, but the Guild Wars 2 Oak Hearts look way more impressive and completely different. Their body structure has totally changed. So maybe that's true of the whole lich thing as well. It's interesting to think that just one lich was such a threat to the world in Guild Wars 1. And I mean, yeah, he had a powerful artifact at his side, the Scepter of War, that being. But nonetheless, he was such a threat. And now here, when we get here in Guild Wars 2, there's actually quite a lot around. It's a cool idea. There's another cool thing of that area as well, where in one of the personal story instances, you can find a super unique, weird, like, statue enemy that doesn't appear anywhere else in the game. It's like an undead, risen Drake gargoyle thing that you fight like a structure, and it's very strange. Lots of personal story here to do with the Vigil, bringing tanks on in. There's a dock back there that you actually have to clear all these giants away from and then get these tanks, which will actually march up the roads to some of these big temples nearby, which I cannot wait for us to actually go and explore, because I mentioned earlier in the playlist, you might remember, it's quite a long playlist at this point, but I did say my favorite meta event was the Lissa Temple in Ur, and well, we will be coming here. The two gods that are mostly associated here are Lissa and Dwaena. And both of their cathedrals, their temple meta events, are really, really, really fun. So there's actually like four meta events on this map, one for each temple, and then two that are based on like assaulting the gates of Arar and just moving forces through the map. So, but the two that are like escorts are nowhere near as important as the temple ones. These temples are not like Balthazar, they won't give you obsidian shards, but they were worthwhile doing just to get elementals on the map for lodestones. And nowadays, you can actually get a lot of champ bags. There's loads of achievements asking you to do these. I wouldn't say that players do the temples as regularly as they do stuff like Tide of Covington and the regular world boss chain. But certainly, players are encouraged to come back to these areas very regularly. In fact, one of the most recent updates, allowing you to swim underwater on the skimmer, also had us come here, where you can find a Largos that are obviously very, very rare. So right now we're underneath the cathedral. It's called the Cathedral of Eternal Radiance. Let's talk a little bit about this meta. First of all, underneath, the meta doesn't really interact. I kind of wish we were looking up right now so you guys could get a good impression of just how massive the structure above us really is. It's freaking huge. This little camp, as far as the open world is concerned, doesn't have much to do. But I like the idea that it's this secret underside, this reflective cove deep beneath the cathedral, because that feels very Lissa-y to me, that there would be secrets abound. Also, by the time Guild Wars 2 comes out, she's kind of the new god of water in a way. She's associated with water, so it's nice to have like this big reflective cove under there. For the open world, there's not much, but the pact in the main story will actually decide to use that as a base of operations. And there's any number of stories going on there. The cathedral's up on our right here, and I think maybe we'll sneak in on the side. If you're using mounts, you can kind of access it in a ton of different ways. But at launch, there was only really the big central ramp, and then maybe this lesser temple here on our left, which is the Temple to Doom. Another one of these old gods like Abaddon, who no longer is being worshipped, is no longer considered a part of the pantheon. And so his temple has kind of fallen into destitution. I really respect what ArenaNet did with that. That Doom gets an actual look in here. They were very careful about the lore and what could be actually happening here in Ur. So even though the maps themselves, I think, are a bit cluttered and a little bit uninspired and could have done better with, you know, another 4 or 5 months of development work purely focused on them, even though they could have been a lot better, as far as the actual point of interest names are concerned and the waypoints and the areas and the regions, it's incredible. It's so good. It's such a treat for anyone that really followed the lore. Like, for example, right outside of the Temple of Lissa here is a place called the Village of Wren. Now, if you were a fan of the first game and you read the scriptures of the gods, you will have heard them talking about Wren, a village where a woman comes to visit and she looks like she... What is it? She's not syphilitic, is she? What is it? I think she has leprosy, maybe, or something? Anyway, she's got some horrible disease. Everyone's staying away from her. No one will help except one person. And this one person then realizes that the old lady that's visited was actually Lyssa in disguise. And so she becomes a favored. And there's this idea of this village in Orr. And well, you get to go to Wren, the village of Wren, or what it now is. So the landscape's changed a lot. There was a big Char invasion. The whole thing got sunk for hundreds of years. Well, not hundreds of years, but like 100 years. And a bit. And then it got raised by Zaitan. And now there's the undead Elder Dragon ravaging it even further. Then there's like a pact campaign that comes through that's probably bombed it and stuff. And so now you can go there in Guild Wars 2 and it's like a temporary pact base. We'll get the point at POI in just a moment. And you're like, oh wow, it's the village of Wren. But it doesn't feel like a village at all. In fact, it feels tiny. It's like... It really is just a POI, and without that POI, you would never think it was a village at all. It's more like a marker letting you know that something was important here historically, but the game itself goes to no length to really show it. You know, it's a far cry from what they did in Kryta, where Shaymor, the village, is there in Guild Wars 1, and Shaymor, the village, is there in Guild Wars 2. It's the same, you know, but in this one, not quite. So anyway, that whole undead area we're in there, that is, yeah, the Temple of Doom. Perhaps once upon a time, it was a big place. But Doom has obviously been usurped by Grenth. There's a load of story here as well in these maps about the whole Grenth, Dwaena, Doom kind of situation. Like, what did it mean when Doom went away? What people kind of forget is that right before Guild Wars 2 came out, sort of, in Guild Wars 1, a lot of the post-game updates dealt with the Underworld and Doom and added him as a proper, like, for lack of a better term, like a raid boss. So the devs were really interested in Doom right around the days that Guild Wars 2 came out. So then it makes sense to me that here in the open world, they'd be doing fun stuff as well. And also, look at this vista. This has got to be one of the coolest vistas in the game. You've got to go through such a route to get up there. A really hidden little door through a little crack in a wall that you could easily miss and have no idea that it was really there. Absolutely fantastic. I remember really struggling to find that on my first time, but being so mind blown and excited when I finally figured it out. The vista itself looks really good too. So yeah, that was just generally a lot about Doom. I like that they did that. Right at the start of this map, there is a Priory Outpost where it's not a Renown Heart, so you kind of miss it all. But this, so this is Wren here, by the way. And at this outpost, you can do all this reading about Guild Wars 1 and Guild Wars 2 lore, and they explain all extra things. It's amazing. I did a whole episode, well, not a whole episode, a big chunk of an episode in the personal story LP that I did, just showing that off because it's so awesome. And unfortunately, with no Renown Hearts, no one's really got any meaning to go there and speak and read that stuff, but it was so, so good. So here we go. We are now at the Lyssa Temple, the Cathedral of Eternal Radiance. This door on the left actually connects to the Doom stuff, and in one of the storylines, you kind of find a connection between these two gods, which is pretty nice. The way this meta event is beautiful, this is, as far as design is concerned, not rewards, not implementation, not incentive or any of that, but as far as the actual design is concerned, I think this is a beautiful idea. The idea is that you've got this giant circular area. In the center is a corrupted priest. Zaitan has taken control of one of the priests of Lyssa, right? Priestesses. And so our job is to kill it and cleanse the temple, and then the pact will be happy here. So the boss is in the center and is like nearly always evident and visible, but the boss defends itself by putting up this big force field. The only way to take the force field down is to come to these really distant areas of this giant circuit, while all these risen trebuchets fire away at you. And in theory, in a perfect implementation, you'd have to go deal with them. Here you can see the pack, don't it? So there's really very little to see. But you've got to spread out. You've got to take these other objectives, each with their own unique mechanics. One of them, bone walls are appearing. One of them, you've got to like charge electricity at a golem. And then once you've claimed all of them, they kind of fire these laser beams in the center and the shield goes down for a moment. You run on into the middle. Now that exact moment, imagine there's 150 players here. Maybe the 50 split in each direction generally. Maybe less than 50, and some other people have been assigned to taking out the trebs in the center. Finally, the force field goes down. You've got a brief moment, and all these just armies of players charge super cinematically from the outside of the ring into the center, and you're one of them. And as you watch, you can see on the horizon to your left and to your right, because it's a circle, this will work no matter where you are. On your left is another road where you see an army charging down to the center. On the right is another army, and you're all coming in to slam down on this boss. And then the boss himself, herself I should say, has all these cool mechanics and weird cryptic dialogue. And there's actually a look away mechanic here, Very common in other MMOs, and especially recent Guild Wars 2 content has added like a look away mechanic, but there's a moment where you have to like not stare at her or you get like stunned, and there's all these risen gorillas that are appearing. It's fantastic. It is really such a good event. And then the force field will come back up and you've got to split again. It's brilliant. And they had it right here at launch. If I could have had a Triple Trouble style update for Ore, in which all the Orion temples got a touch up, I would have loved that, if only just to see what they did with Lissa, because all the fundamentals are in there. It just needed the tuning and then the incentives. That's it for the player, you know, some kind of reward that makes it really worthwhile. They did kind of add a bit of incentive for a while, but it's kind of petered out now as most people have collected those items. So yeah, really, really nice. On the note of a big Orion update as well, I will point out, after launch, there was a Once Upon a Time quote from the game director who suggested they really did want to do a big Ore update. That they were looking at it as one of the big formats of Endgame or whatever, but a lot of that kind of got swept aside when they went for Season 1. I mean, Christ, I could do a big video about all the concessions that were made in terms of like even returning to Guild Wars 1 Beyond content and stuff because of Season 1. In any case, so we never got in the end, but they did talk about it, and there was kind of a half-hearted release in which they added a special mechanic for Karma here, where you can buy basically loot boxes and you open them and sometimes you get a mini Balthazar out of them and you'll get extra stuff, but it just wasn't enough and it didn't actually affect the content here. And then as well, as I was talking about in the Straits of Devastation episode, when we went to the Mega Server system, I think this region lost a lot of stuff too. So we find a Risen Knight. That event's actually really cool. You're obviously watching it get fought at the moment here on the Path to Arar meta, but you can actually see that thing flying around really fast in all kinds of crazy directions if you're just sort of walking around on your own and it's not in a fight, and its shadow like gets cast across the floor. That's something that happens a lot here anyway because of all the massive dragons in the sky. They'll sometimes cast a shadow as you're running, which is nice. You got a kind of a feel for that at Blazed Steps as well. But for that event, you could actually see, you know, the events are marked by a skull on the minimap. You could see the skull zapping all over the place. It was really scary. Like, they actually set up a lot of ambience there, the idea that you're being hunted by this knight. And as a level 80 champion at this late in the game, it's kind of true that it's really scary. So here, this is amazing as well. All right, so there's the whole story about the pilgrimage of King Doric coming here to plead with the gods to take magic away, and that kind of triggers the gods' civil war and the loss of Abaddon and all that stuff. And anyway, if you look at the area names here, like we're in King Doric's passage. Wait, or is this Reza's passage? You've just got so much history here. There's so many amazing things. That area is quite challenging as well. We get a lot of value out of our movement as a Mesmer, but again, there's dangerous stuff that haunts in that corridor. You really do start to get the sense that whether you're in a meta or not, whether events are scaled up or not, it's a good idea to not adventure alone, especially at launch combat balance, you know, really. So we've kind of skipped a little bit past the Dwayna statue, not just statue, temple here. I guess we'll return there later. But the place is obviously called Malkor's Leap. And the story there is that there was a human who was responsible for crafting all the statues we have of the gods. And there's kind of a thing with the gods where you can't really look at them very long without going blind in all their magical energy, their mystery, their power. But this guy really wanted to create depictions of them. So he did so, and when it came to doing Dwayna, the leader of the gods and the goddess of life, he fell in love with her. And as he was in love with her, once the statue was done, he couldn't look upon her anymore. And in his sadness and the tragedy of it, he killed himself here. He jumped into the water near her her temple, which is, you know, really poetic and cool. Listen, I'm a bit of a Lissa fanboy. I always kind of felt like that was more of a Lissa story, to be honest, because she's the goddess of beauty and she manipulates your mind and your emotions and stuff. But the devs wrote it was more about Dwayna, and it was a nice little touch there. In fact, if you read the third novel, you can actually, there's a chapter of that book here. There's quite a lot that goes on here dealing with sailing to this area of the world where there wasn't much ore at all visible, because this was before Zaitan rose up. So it's some sailors out in the water here, and they see just a few rocks jutting out, known as Malkor's Fingers. It's kind of the big climactic end of the first act of that book takes place here, in which you see the moment where the lands rise to a certain degree. And in fact, there's some big shipwrecks that are very iconic to that book here. If you saw the Lion's Arch City tour recently, You'll know that there were some references to Goodbye Mariner there as well. Well, you can kind of see some good stuff from the book on this one as well, particularly this sunken arc down here. So yeah, that vista as well. God, I got to talk about that vista. That was really challenging. Even Tech Zune struggled there a bit, sliding around a little bit. I remember really sucking at that launch. Like, taking 20 minutes or something just to be able to climb up there. You know, getting used to how exactly the collision on these jumps work and where you would slide off and stuff. That was a horrendous vista. I remember really struggling with that one. That area of the map's kind of cool as well because it's a bit obscure. It's a bit out of the way. It's a bit weird. There's more of those spirits that are just sort of swimming around there. And in fact, I think the scale spirit that's swimming around there, I think it's the spirit of indulgence or something, is kind of unique. You only really find him around in that place. But there's also a nice event where you get to fight some risen bosses. I think it's three bosses at once. And one of them is like a risen champion, like sea urchin, which is a very, very rare variety of enemy. You see one of them in Caledon Forest. And then there's one here. There's very, very few of them around. So that's always felt quite special to me. So here we are at the Lights waypoint. That waypoint's quite important because it's like the packed rally camp from the previous map. That never gets contested, so it's kind of like a safe place to a certain degree. Anyway, we'll move up into the Duena temple now, where there's plenty to see and do. The meta event for this one is like a really long escort. A lot of the other temples ask you to just stay in the vicinity of the temple itself. But they really change it up here, where you enter the temple, do a fight immediately, and then you have to actually chase Malkor's ghost. Malkor's ghost itself is still here, unable to move on. And you chase him out into the water where there's all these old statues, unfinished statues that he cast away in life because they didn't depict Duena perfectly enough. And then you got to like convince him to return by attacking him over and over and over again. He reappears and you fight the Risen Priestess of Duena here. Now the Risen Priestess of Duena, it has an amazing design. Looks almost like a harpy. One thing I think a lot of people don't realize is, you know, I've talked a lot about enemy variety and stuff. Each of the risen versions of the priests and priestesses at these temples is a super unique looking model and character. And you can only find them here. And also the final path of the final dungeon in explorable mode in Arai. You can find them there as well. But out here in the temples, they're scaled up really big and they look so cool. I love that the devs put that extra attention to detail there. So yeah, hero challenge there is literally just a lore hero challenge. It's just read. That's it. And then you've got this vista, this diving goggles to jump down to the water near some more spirits. Yeah, and what we're basically doing with those diving goggles is kind of tasteless, to be honest. But that's where Malkor jumped off. That is where he fell. And we get a little statue down here at the bottom in the waters. And the idea is he would never survive that fall, but we can because we put on the diving goggles, I guess. That might not have looked very impressive to you guys, that moment there in the footage. But I have to say, that has to have been like the biggest drop at launch. Try to think of a world where there's no gliding and there's no mounts. When you actually did big drops at launch, you felt something. I remember in original Lion's Arch, there was a diving board there as well, which was maybe like a fifth of the height of what we just did. And that was enough to really be, oh my God, we're doing something crazy here. And then this one in awe, that was such a huge, huge, huge jump. Truly incredible. So that tunnel we're swimming towards that here, you've got another meta event here in which the Order of Whispers are trying to infiltrate an Inquest base. So the Inquest are here. You also find a Quaggan village here. I kind of don't like that about this map. I'm curious to see what you guys think in the comments. I kind of don't like it because I feel like this should be super... Look how dark the water gets here as well. That happens if you swim too far away or too down in these regions, which is massive open water before you hit the currents. It's a nice little touch. I kind of just don't like the idea that people can set up any kind of permanent base here. I think it undermines the idea of the Pact going through all these struggles to set up. And yet, you know, here's the Inquest. They are underwater and they are offshore. I get it. And that's the same for any Quaggan that you find living in the area. So maybe it's sort of all right. But nonetheless, one thing I do love about this is these windows. You see, while you're swimming outside, you can actually... And there's a point of interest inside, but if you swim underneath, you can grab it, which means you can skip the meta. This is wild to me. I remember finding this without having done the meta, and I genuinely thought finally it was one of those moments. Look, that looks like you can walk around in there. That does not look like there's water or anything. That looks like a proper place where you can stand inside. The way that they set the... And there, you've got to grind just right against the waypoint. That's a big skip, that, by the way. It means that you can avoid all the dynamic events. And that one, I'm not actually sure if ArenaNet had intended or what, but that's a big skip. Anyway, it looks, even the way that they have the waypoint positioned in that room, it looks like a normal waypoint, the control panels. It's actually all fake. When you do the meta, you'll realize the lab is flooded. You're just going to swim inside. Which was, in a way, kind of really fascinating to me, and in another way, really kind of disappointing to me when I first played this. But yeah, I thought that they had actually figured out how to do the whole pockets of water in the engine, and it turned out they hadn't. Maybe the idea is that during the event, when you open the doors, the water's like rushing in or whatever, but they don't play any kind of animation for that. That whole meta is kind of weird. There's all these tunnels and places you can walk up into. You see there's a Karma Merchant on the minimap right now. You can like pop out at the other side of the lab up there by going through an Asura gate. Really, really wild. So here we get one of these beautiful arches. There's all these rings in ore. At the start of the next episode in the playlist, which will actually be the final episode of the playlist, you can find a hero challenge that kind of talks about these things being super mysterious and all, why are they here and what's going on. But I guess that'll be for the next part, which is crazy, guys. We're right at the end here. And this is where the Order of Whispers meta event starts. Lots of things to collect here real quick. I think we basically only have like one more thing to get, which we sort of missed. A little bit inefficient here, I suppose. But yeah, another Inquest lab. I don't know. I just don't know what I think about the Inquest. And they're kind of active up near the Pyrite Peninsula as well, which is fine. We get some good lore out of that. They're meddling. But I want ore to feel as dangerous as possible, because it should be. And well, there you have it, guys. So that is 100% map completion for the Malkor's Leap. Lovely map, very cool name. I can't help but think when it comes to Malkor's Leap about all the lore associated with it, because it's in the very name, you know. It's talking about something very specific. It's not just like Sparkfly Fen, and the word Sparkfly doesn't mean much. Malkor's Leap means something. And so yeah, thanks guys, hope you enjoyed, and I'll see you for the final part of the open world playlist tomorrow in the Cursed Shore. See you there.